Intel Arc A770 Limited Edition has been on the market for over 4 months now. Since then, Intel has provided some pretty impressive driver updates that have had a significant impact on performance. So I think now is a good time to revisit this card and see how it stands up against its current competition, the RTX 3060, the RTX 6600 XT. So without further ado, let's get to it. Since my last check-in at the end of January, Intel has dropped some pretty big news, the biggest of which being a price drop on the Arc A750, down to $249, which makes it a pretty compelling case at that price range. My favorite news, though, was the new standalone Arc Control Center, something many of us have asked for. If you've been following along with my monthly driver update series, then the news of massive performance uplifts is pretty unsurprising. But it sounds like going forward, we should expect a focus from Intel on stability and normal day one drivers, as opposed to major swings in raw performance. Big increases in performance are likely to come from game-specific optimizations rather than general architectural fixes. And that's what led me to the video today. And I've been tracking the performance of the Arc A770 Limited Edition month to month since it was released, and performance has pretty much plateaued at this point. But that's not a bad thing. Because of that, I felt now was a good time to see how it stacks up against its expected competition rather than just looking at similar numbers to last month. Before we get to the performance results, I wanted to quickly cover the test system used and what cards are being put up for comparison. All tests were performed on my X570 test bench with the Ryzen 9 5900X at the helm and resizable bar engaged. 32GB of DDR4 3600MHz DRAM rounds out the core of the system, and all of the games are played from a PCIe Gen 4 NVMe SSD. The graphics cards that I'm looking at today include the aforementioned Intel Arc A770 Limited Edition on the Arc Driver 4091, the EVGA GeForce RTX 3060 12GB XC Black Gaming Edition on GeForce 528.49, and the ASUS ROG Strix Radeon RX 6600 XT with Radeon 22.11.2. Now on to the games. Cyberpunk 2077 continues to do well on the Steam charts thanks to tons of bug fixes and updates, but unfortunately at 1080p Ultra settings, numbers for this title are not in the A770's favor, with it having the weakest performance here. However, it does catch up at 1440p, and while the performance is not earth-shattering, it does show that the wider memory bus is able to breathe a bit more at the higher resolution. The A770 does show off pretty weak 1% lows though, so it's not the smoothest option. Watch Dogs Legions presents interesting results since the A770 saw a drop in performance after its launch driver. But at 1080p, it is still able to best the RTX 3060, and the 1% lows are better than the RX 6600 XT. However, at 1440p, the A770 has a commanding lead, as that 8GB of VRAM on the RX 6600 XT holds the card back at the Ultra settings. Horizon Zero Dawn is running fast enough on all cards, but at 1080p Ultimate Quality, the A770 is significantly behind the other two in performance. When things are kicked up to 1440p, everything is pretty tight across the board. Once again, we see a shift for the A770 when moving to that higher resolution. Borderlands 3 at badass settings in DX12 mode is rather good showing for the A770 at 1080p, with it ahead of the RTX 3060 by a fair clip, still falling behind the RX 6600 XT, but at 1440p we see a lead change, with the A770 squeaking ever so slightly ahead of the RX 6600 XT. Unfortunately, the RTX 3060 really isn't competing in this game with average frame rates as well as 1% lows. Troy Total War may not be a game that requires high frame rates, but it certainly doesn't hurt to have them. At 1080p Ultra, the A770 is sitting comfortably ahead of the RTX 3060, but quite a bit behind the RX 6600 XT. But at 1440p, that lead is gone, with the A770 and 6600 XT essentially neck and neck. Shadow of the Tomb Raider at the highest settings, sans ray tracing, is not the best look for the A770. While it keeps up with the other cards at 1080p average frame rates, the 1% lows are quite a bit behind the other two. 1440p once again yields a better experience for the A770 here, but those 1% lows are still lagging behind. Call of Duty Modern Warfare 2 is a game that I was very happy to see uplifts in last month, but it wasn't quite enough to take the RX 6600 XT down. But compared to the other cards, the A770 delivers much better experience thanks to a more consistent 1% low relative to its average FPS. It was very surprising to see how high the 6600 XT can hit, but those lows sure don't feel great. Assassin's Creed Valhalla at very high settings shows the A770 lagging at 1080p, being a good bit behind the RX 6600 XT, but right on the heels of the RTX 3060. At 1440p, we see a more even playing field though, with the A770 just managing to overtake the RTX 3060. Counter-Strike Global Offensive is one of those titles where Intel fixed a major flaw recently and massively improved performance. But was it enough to come in first? Not quite. At 1080p, the A770 trails by a bit in average FPS, but is close when it comes to 1% lows. At 1440p, once again, we see it pick up the pace and match the RTX 3060, but surprisingly, the RX 6600 XT is still far and away ahead of both. Forspoken, love it or hate it, is the newest title in my testing, and if there's ever been an argument for updated drivers, I think this is likely going to be the poster child for it. The A770 and the RTX 3060 are both pretty well matched at 1080p and 1440p at high settings, but the RX 6600 is not even showing up to play here. Wow. Either way, this one is tougher to run, and all of them struggle to keep a consistent 1% lows for smooth gameplay. Okay, I lied. Returnal is the absolute newest game on the list, and is quickly turning into my favorite title of this year. It also features a killer benchmark and heavy visual features. Looking at the results using Epic settings, sans ray tracing, we see the A770 and 6600 XT neck and neck performance-wise at 1080p. But just as we've come to see in other titles, the tables flip at 1440p and the A770 breaks away from the other two. Luckily, this title does feature a robust list of scaling technologies to help get those cards well over that 60fps hump. Now, I'll be remiss if I didn't at least take a brief look at ray tracing performance, so let's do that before we wrap up. This time we're only looking at 1080p numbers without any resolution modifiers, so raw RT performance. Of course, the modifiers would help improve performance, so keep that in mind. Now back to Cyberpunk 2077, this time with ray tracing medium preset, and it's not bad at all in my opinion. The A770 is right on the heels of the RTX 3060, basically within margin of error. And if you're wanting to use RT in Cyberpunk and above that smooth 30, you're going to definitely call in DLSS or FSR support. Hitman 3 is a great game with a good use of ray traced effects, and I went for 1080p ultra details with RT enabled. This was a surprising result, with the ARC A770 able to deliver a solid gameplay experience and the only one to hit over 60fps here. Adding in the use of XeSS would provide an even more of a boost, but otherwise native 1080p is perfectly playable. And last but not least is Chernobylite. And at 1080p Ultra with ray tracing at high, it gives us another very impressive result for the A770. It's far and away the fastest graphics card in this game at these settings, and this game does support FSR to help get that over the 60fps barrier though, so that would be a good option for stability. I'm truly surprised by these ray tracing results though. This price level, most people don't even bother with it, but they might think twice with the A770. Well, there we have it. With all of the game numbers wrapped, we can see where the A770 sits right now, and in my opinion, it's right in line with where it's priced. As much as most of you would like for me to sit here and state a definitive winner, I really can't. Most of these cards can now be found for about the same price, but the Nvidia and AMD cards do seem to fluctuate more, so it comes down to personal priorities. While the RX 6600 XT overwhelmingly takes the lead at 1080p, at 1440p and in ray tracing it struggles to keep up. The RTX 3060 is very much middle of the road and reasonably consistent one here, and also has access to the superior DLSS upscaling tech. but the A770 puts up a fight. It manages to hold its own at 1080p, but comfortably drives 1440p thanks to its wide memory bus and large memory pool. With modern games like Forspoken and Hogwarts Legacy chewing into VRAM, there's certainly the argument there for more of it in your GPU choice. There's very little A770 leaves off the table right now performance-wise, and as opposed to even a couple of months ago, I can confidently recommend it as an option. Is that to say it should be your only option? No, you're going to need to decide based on the games that you're playing, as well as other factors surrounding how you use your PC. But it is kind of fun to not have a clear winner on the table. The final hurdle for Intel to jump over seems to be around stability and reliability at this point. While I haven't run into a ton of problems recently, others continue to, and it's going to be really hard to shake off that stigma, even if they get there. But that's it for me today. I would love to hear your feedback on these cards, and if you had $350 and had to spend it on either of these three cards, which one would you get and why? Sound off in the comment section and make sure you're subscribed here at PC World for even more PC hardware and software goodness.